So this week, we're making room for the first of our two key psychologists to take his place on our unit, Stanley Milgram. And this video is a little animation I've made where I describe the Milgram experiment, what he did, and why he did it. So I've made some improvements since the previous version of this video. I've tried to improve the quality of the animation, and I've just put my finishing touches to it. So I'll render it out for you in just a minute and play it for you. It's a 3D environment that I've created where Milgram's most, the rooms where Milgram's most well-known obedience experiments happened. This is a room at Yale University in the US. And you might recognize the shock machine there, carefully crafted. And the animation's based on, or the 3D model's based on actual historical photographs of the rooms. And I've also put in some actual shots of some of the participants. So I've blended those into the animation. And I've also blended in some more recent shots from a movie about the Milgram experiments. It's called The Experimenter. It's a movie from 2015, starred Peter Sarsgaard and Winona Ryder. So in the animation, I'll start off by giving you some context on why Milgram conducted the study. I'll give you a bit of social history behind it all and a bit about his own motivations for doing the work. And then I pan around the rooms and explain the experiment to you. Okay, so I shall get on and play it for you. Here it is.
So Milgram's study on obedience. He actually ran a large number of experiments, but I'll describe the most well-known one. The year was 1961. Stanley Milgram, a professor in social psychology at the prestigious Yale University, designed an experiment to study obedience. Why did he do this? Well, it relates to the Nazis. After the Second World War and the full horrors of the Holocaust came to the public's attention, he was one of a large number of social psychologists who sought to understand how people could do such horrible things to other people. You know, how the Nazis could systematically murder around 16 million people, and those people were killed because of their ethnicity, their religion, their disability status, their sexuality, and their political beliefs. Among them were 6 million Jews. It's why it's known as the Jewish Holocaust. At the time of the Holocaust, Germany was steeped in the propaganda of a dictator, Adolf Hitler, promising worldwide domination through the extermination of Jewish populations and those other marginalized groups. The systematic killing of those people that happened in concentration camps like Auschwitz and Belsen occurred over a long period of time, and many carrying out those acts purportedly believed that the fate of Germany in the 1930s and 1940s was due directly to the subversive influence of Jewish people and other minority groups, and this belief was fed to the people in daily Nazi propaganda. Stanley Milgram was Jewish, and his immediate and extended family had been affected by the Holocaust. He had a strong interest in helping people understand how the mass murder of Jewish people by the Nazis could have happened, not least to prevent history repeating itself. So he designed a social psychological experiment. He advertised in the area around the university, an area called New Haven, for volunteers to take part in the experiment. The experiment was advertised as a study on memory and learning, and he specifically sought to recruit males in the age range of 20 to 50 and wanted to include a mix of professional and non-professional workers. Participants were paid $4.50, and they were paid that when they turned up. So it wasn't conditional on them completing or taking part in the experiment. They just had to turn up. From the people who applied to become volunteers, he selected 40 who he felt would be a representative sample of the population as a whole. The study took place at Yale University in Lindsley Chittenden Hall, part of a prestigious-looking university campus. When each participant arrived at Lindsley Chittenden Hall, they were shown into a room where they met the experimenter and another participant. At least they were told that the other person was a participant. Actually, that other person was an actor who was part of the research team. The experimenter explained that the research was looking into whether the use of punishment helped people learn. The experimenter then asked the two participants to draw lots to determine which one would be the teacher in the experiment and which would be the learner. But the process was rigged, so the actor got the role of learner and the participant got the role of teacher. And the experimenter then takes the learner and teacher into a room where there's a table and a chair and arm straps on the chair, along with some electrical equipment on the desk, one piece of equipment designed to deliver electrical shocks through electrodes attached to the arm straps. And there was also a four-way switch, which was used by the learner to indicate their response to items on the memory test that was about to happen. Now, the experimenter tells the participant that the straps were there to ensure that the learner would not escape. And the experimenter then gives the participant, you know, the teacher, a mild electric shock from the electrode so they can feel what it's like. The learner then takes a seat and the experimenter straps the learner into the chair and attaches the electrodes to their arms. Now the learner, remember they're an actor, tells the experimenter that they're feeling anxious because they have a history of heart problems and asks if the shocks will be dangerous. And the experimenter says, nope, the shocks are painful, but not dangerous. And the experimenter then takes the participant, the teacher, to an adjacent room where there's a chair, a table, a microphone and a speaker, and the large, ominous-looking shock generator machine. Now, the machine has a number of switches labelled in increments of 15 volts going up to 450 volts, and under each number is a category that goes from mild shock to danger, severe shock, and the final category is just XXX. The participant is given the instructions for the memory test and then reads out a series of word pairs, which is the teaching phase of the experiment. The testing phase then begins with the teacher reading out the first word from each word pair, followed by four words. The teacher asks the learner to indicate which of those four words is the correct word for that word pair. If the learner makes a mistake or doesn't respond, the teacher is instructed to give a shock, starting with 15 volts, but stepping up that voltage for each subsequent shock, going all the way up to 450 volts. By around 100 volts or so, the learner, the actor, starts yelling, then screaming from the other room, shouting that they had said that they had a heart condition, that their heart was giving them trouble, and insisting they be let out. Then, after a few more shocks, the learner goes silent, and the experimenter instructs the teacher to carry on. Now, if the participant says they don't want to keep giving the shocks, the experimenter gives one of a number of prompts. They say, please continue, or the experiment requires you to continue, or it's absolutely necessary for you to continue, or you have no other choice but to continue. Of course, the learner purposefully gives wrong answers, and the learner's voice from the other room, the screaming and the yelling and so on, is actually a tape recording that is just being played back. Of course, also, no shocks were being delivered to the learner. Now, what did Milgram find? Well, he found that a high proportion of people were prepared to obey the instructions of the experimenter, even when it appeared the shocks would cause significant harm to the learner. And this is the finding that shocked the world. Now, in the next video, I'm going to talk about what society's response to the experiment was and what psychology's response was as well. And I'll give you something to think about in relation to the vested interests behind the different responses to the Milgram experiment.
Thanks for watching. And in the next video, we'll talk about how Milgram's work was received by mainstream psychology. And I'll give you a sneaky peek about that. Mainstream psychology didn't like it very much. Actually, didn't like it at all. And it's got a lot to do with the Nazis. So I'll tell you all about that in the next video. Till then, ta-da.